Welcome to Mindlight, the program designed to stimulate your thinking about life. My name is Anna Vitale. Horses. Horses, horses, horses. When I think of horses, I think of the embodiment of freedom. I think of speed. I think of meadows and rolling hills and absolute beauty. Who doesn't think horses are beautiful? Well, on this show, we're going to be talking about horses, but in a different way. In fact, when I think about horses, images come into my mind. Images that show freedom and speed. Images that are very much like this.
Can't take me. Yeah! Gotta fight another fight. I gotta run another night. I get it out, check it out. I'm on my way and it don't feel right. I gotta get me back. It's a fact, it's okay, I'll find a way. It ain't gonna take me down no way. Yeah. Don't touch a thing till you know what's inside it. Don't push me, I'll fight it. Never gonna give it, never gonna give it up, no. If you can't catch a wave, then you're never gonna ride it. You can't come uninvited. Never gonna give it, never gonna give it up, no. It can't take me, I'm free.
On today's program, we're going to look at carriage horses in New York City. Are they a real tourist attraction, or is it just plain animal cruelty? I have two very special guests with me today. They are Senator Tony Avella, New York Senator for the 11th District, and Edita Birnkrant. She is the New York Director of Friends of Animals. I'd like to welcome you both to Mindlight, and I thank you for taking the time out of your very busy schedules to be here.
Well, thank you for having us on our show.
There's a history behind horse-drawn carriages in New York City, and something that's going on right now, which is a movement to ban horse-drawn carriages. I think, Edita, you have a history, your group has a history of what's been going on with that.
Yes.
How did your group become involved with the carriage horse industry?
Well, Friends of Animals has been around since 1957, actually. We've always had our New York office right on, in Columbus Circle on 60th and Broadway, and that's kind of in Carriage Horse Central. and it's always been an issue that's been on the radar screen. And for decades, advocate groups and New Yorkers who cared about horses tried their best, tried with many different ways with campaigns to improve the lives of the horses, to get better regulations, and nothing really amounted to much. The horses were still exploited and abused every day on the streets. Nothing had really changed. Year after year, it was the same story.
Was there a particular incident that attracted you most?
In 2006, there was a particularly horrible accident involving a carriage horse running out of control and smashing into a oncoming vehicle. And this was a very high profile accident. It happened on a rainy night. Apparently the horse had just spooked, which is common for horses, ran out of control. There were people injured. There were pictures of the horse bloodied, the car smashed. So this really galvanized the animal community in New York City to get together, and Friends of Animals was a leader in that, in forming a coalition to focus 100% on banning the industry and enacting legislation that would finally get this industry out of New York City and get all these horses that were in danger every day and causing a public safety risk, as well as these accidents show, into sanctuaries where they could live their lives free, as that video that you showed beautifully showed, able to run free, all the things that they're denied being carriage horses. So that from that moment on was kind of the starting point, and it led up to now, and you know, we have Tony Avella to thank for so much
Senator
of that.
And Senator Avella, you have been involved in the movement to ban horse-drawn carriages in New York City when you were a city council member.
Correct, correct. And I actually got started on the issue based upon that 2006 incident. Mm-hmm. I was home watching the TV news and saw the accident, and it caused me to think about it.
You know, I was going to ask you how you got involved.
Yeah, that's how I got involved, thinking that, you know, why do we allow carriage horses in Midtown Manhattan anymore? I mean, does it really make sense? And it was from that point that I started to look into the issue, and my first foray into it was to introduce legislation in the city council to restrict them to Central Park. Mm-hmm. But the more investigation that I did into the issue, I realized even if we did that, one, it doesn't end the cruelty to the animal, and it still doesn't address the huge safety factor to the passengers and motorists and pedestrians. And that's when in 2007, working with all the groups, the animal rights groups, including Edita, that I introduced legislation in the council to ban the horse-driven carriages in New York City. Unfortunately, we have a mayor and we have a speaker of the city council who are supporting the carriage horse owners. So it didn't move, although we had a hearing. We had hundreds of people come and testify against the industry.
Testifying against the industry.
And the only people who came to testify were the owners themselves and some of the drivers. Mm-hmm. Since I've been elected to the state senate and the bill didn't move in the city council, I thought, well, we may have an easier time of passing the legislation in Albany. So that's when I introduced the bill in Albany to ban the horse-driven carriage industry in New York City. And Linda Rosenthal in the assembly has introduced the same as bill. And with this session, this upcoming session, 2012, we're going to make a real effort to get more senators and assembly members to sign on. Mm-hmm. As Edita said, you know, it's time to end this. Mm-hmm. Really, this is huge cruelty to the animal.
It is. And seemingly off the topic, but you represent the 11th
senatorial district.
And someone asked me, well, what does that cover? What district is that?
Well, it covers College Point, Whitestone, Bayside, Little Neck, Douglaston, mm-hmm. Glen Oaks, Belrose, Floral Park. I could go on and on and on.
And have people in that area become involved? Or?
Oh, they have. You know, and that's the interesting thing. People came up to me when I first started this and said, well, you don't live in Manhattan. That's where the carriage horses are. Why aren't you? You know, why would somebody from Queens be interested in this? And I basically said that everybody should be interested in fighting cruelty to animals. I think we've grown up as a society to recognize that's no longer appropriate. And I introduced the ban legislation because I thought it was the right thing to do. But I have been pleasantly surprised that the overwhelming responses that I've gotten, emails, letters over the years, has been easy 10-1 in support of the ban. And generally, the people who are opposed to it are usually just the owners and the drivers.
Mayor Bloomberg, though, had something to say about that, didn't he? He said,
oh, yes.
I think he said that it's going to hurt New York City tourism.
Nonsense.
What do you think about
that? I think that's just absurd. We have, anytime we do public outreach or demonstrations. We have so many tourists. We have over 100,000 petitions on the signature. People all over the world say that it actually pains them to see this. Sometimes they avoid Midtown Manhattan because they don't want to see the horses toiling and suffering. And the idea that people come to New York City explicitly to ride a horse drawn carriage is absurd. I doubt you could find a single person that, you know, I think for tourism, when options are there, people will take it. But when we educate people, when they understand what goes on behind the scenes, what this really entails for the horses, many times, every single time we're out there educating the public, people, families, tourists, couples, they do not take the carriage rides because, you know, what might attract them to the ride is, you know, being able to see the horse, you know, be in, you know, riding the carriage. But when you understand the physiology of a horse and when you understand what they need to be healthy psychologically and physically, and then you realize what the reality of their life is in New York City, it's really just abuse. It is abuse. They are deprived of everything they need. They get absolutely no turnout, which just means the ability to run free, which every horse needs. Horses evolved as prey animals, so they're social animals.
Yeah, describe the prey animal.
Right.
Aspect.
A prey animal means that they evolved to run,
from things.
Right. You know, kind of the fight or flight response. Mm-hmm. So horses, they evolved to be prey animals, and that means when they're frightened, and they do frighten easily, they just bolt, they run, and then consider it later. So that's proven to be disastrous and lethal for some of the horses. It's just a crazy situation when you look at it logically. To put prey animals, these very large, heavy animals that can weigh up to 2,000 pounds, strap these, you know, carriages to them, put tourists in them, and put them in Midtown Manhattan, you know, some of the most chaotic streets, with ambulances, fire trucks, pedestrians, bike riders, ambulances, all these things that are a stimuli that can frighten a horse and often do. And it's a disaster waiting to happen, mm-hmm. and it needs to stop.
Well, even the Department of Health and Mental Hygiene in the city of New York puts out a training manual mm-hmm. for the drivers. And the manual itself says what can spook a carriage horse. And it's basically a loud horn, air brakes on a truck, music, loud mm-hmm. noise.
That makes
sense.
This
is part of Midtown right. traffic.
Every minute of the day.
Every minute. So it's absurd that we allow these animals to be in Midtown traffic. And again, it's not only cruelty to the animal, it's a danger to everybody around them because the horse doesn't understand what's happening.
No.
And as Edita said, they will get spooked at the simplest thing and they will just take off. Mm-hmm. And when they take off, they're a danger to themselves, they're a danger to the driver and the passengers and everybody else around them, the motorists and pedestrians.
Mm-hmm.
And people have been injured mm-hmm. in these accidents, not only the horses. People have been injured.
The latest bad accident that happened over the summer, the carriage driver was actually in a coma for several weeks. That was a serious, you know, injury as a result. But, you know,
how about pedestrians?
Pedestrians have been injured, yes. There was actually an elderly bike rider that was riding in Central Park that got hit by a runaway carriage horse, and he suffered a broken hip, and that was just someone on a bicycle, because even when they're in Central Park, you have to realize that that's a heavily trafficked area. There's cars, there's bicycles, there's pedestrians, there's a myriad of things that can spook them and cause them to frighten, and there was one accident a few years ago that resulted in a horse dying, that the horse was spooked just from a street musician, hitting a drum.
I think most of us, you know, here in Queens and mm-hmm. wherever this program is going to be viewed, don't really get a chance to, except for Manhattan, of course, don't really get a chance to see what the life of a carriage horse is like. And so I have a little clip that I retrieved from Humane Society of the United States. And whenever the control room is ready, you'll play it. Okay.
These images conjure up ideas of tradition, times of old.
People may think of horse-drawn carriages as something that's quaint or perhaps romantic.
But this is anything but. Nose-to-tail pipes, stop-and-go traffic. The horses are forced to endure daily near misses of traffic crashes. Sometimes they don't miss. These pictures show what happens when traditional times of old meet the modern era of one of the world's biggest cities.
No horse should be forced to parade up and down congested traffic, weaving in and out of taxi cabs and trucks and tourists. This is a recipe for disaster for both people and horses. It's unsafe, it's inhumane, and it's a throwback to the past.
An independent audit conducted by the New York City comptroller found the horses are not provided with enough water and in the summer risk overheating on hot asphalt.
The horses are forced to work year-round. In a city like New York, the conditions are just too tough on horses.
But no one here seems to notice, and while the horse, who's often elderly, is only supposed to work a maximum of 9 hours a day, those laws are not enforced. So customers looking for adventure keep getting in the carriage, putting the horse through another agonizing trot in harsh conditions. Unfortunately, the cruelty doesn't end there. When the horses are returned to their stables, they have barely enough room to lie down, essential to achieve a deep sleep. And even if they could lie down, there's not enough bedding to make it comfortable. The comptroller also found that the horses are forced to stand in their own waste because of inadequate drainage in stables.
Horse-drawn carriages do not belong in congested cities like New York City.
For these horses, there is no reward for the misery they're put through. And the Humane Society of the United States wants people to know what they're getting into when they get in a horse-drawn carriage.
This is Anna Vitale, and I'm back with my guest, Senator Tony Avella from the 11th District of New York, and Edita Birnkrant, the director of Friends of Animals in New York. And we're discussing a ban that's been proposed against horse-drawn carriages, and Senator Avella is a co-sponsor of the bill, S-5013, along with Assembly Member Linda Rosenthal. You became involved because you saw this accident.
That's correct, in 2006,
just watching it on TV. But you know what, when you think about, I'm gonna say something, it sounds like I don't care about the horses, but what about the carriage drivers? I mean, this is cruelty to them, isn't it? If you stop this business.
Well, obviously that's an issue that we have to address. And in fact, we have reached out to the owners on numerous occasions to say, we will sit down and work with you to make sure that we can set up a training program, a retraining program for the drivers. And there are people who have stepped forward to say they will fund that program privately. There are a lot of people interested in ending this inhumane practice. We will work with the drivers to come up with something.
At a time when there's no jobs?
And no, well, they could be retrained into other things. In fact, one of the suggestions that's been made is that taxi drivers, because they seem to know their way around the city. Mm-hmm. There are things that we can do. We want to make sure that nobody loses their job. You also have to understand that a lot of these are part-time jobs. They're not really full-time, they're part-time.
I thought they were businesses.
Well, they have the owners, and the owners hire a lot of the drivers. Some of the owners are also drivers. I would say, you know, Edita, you correct me if I'm wrong, but there's probably about 200 drivers and for the entire, for the whole system.
Most, I would say probably half are part-time.
Right.
So this is a
part-time,
relatively very small industry when you think about it. And I think that to use the excuse that we can't end this practice of animal abuse because of the job issue, just there's no justification for it anymore. It's something wrong that shouldn't be happening, and there are other jobs.
But
that,
aren't there agencies that monitor cruelty?
That's
there are laws on the books. It's up to the ASPCA to monitor. Department of Health should be involved, but they're not. Department of Consumer Affairs is supposed to regulate the amount that they charge and make sure that they're not overcharging. I actually had a hearing on my city council ban bill, and it came out that the representative from the Department of Consumer Affairs didn't even know what the law was on how much they could charge at the time. Huh. Nobody is monitoring these individuals, the owners.
So in other words, the laws are on the books, but
right.
nobody's
not enforced. If a law is not enforced, does it really exist? We have, and other activists have, countless documentation of horses being out during heat waves mm-hmm. in violation of the law. You saw the video that you showed earlier. During blizzards, snowstorms, the worst weather, this is all in violation of the law. It's just that the city doesn't do their job at enforcing the laws. They throw it on the ASPCA, and the ASPCA only has one or two agents mm-hmm. for over 200 horses and 68 carriages, that's just inadequate. So basically, it's like the Wild West out
right.
there. They do what they want.
And if you speak to the owners or the owners association, they'll always say, we really care about our horses. But why is it always the ASPCA that has to go out on these 90-degree days, mm-hmm. on the snow days, and tell them to take the horses off the street? They never do it voluntarily. They have to be forced. They really mm-hmm. don't take care of these horses.
Right.
They work them to death, 8-9 hours a day, 7 days a week. They're not given proper watering. They're not given proper rest. And at the end of their shift, they have to walk through midtown traffic again, as you saw in the video, and go into the stable. And the carriage, believe it or not, is left on the first floor, and the poor horse has to walk up a steep incline to get to the stalls on the second and third floors.
And I wouldn't even call them stables. I would say that they're warehouse cells. When you see what these buildings actually look like, they look like condemned warehouses. These are not adequate stables. So the horses are confined basically 24/7. They go from being confined in the shafts of the carriages in these horrible, dangerous situations day in and day out, up 9-10 hours a day, 7 days a week. Then they go to their warehouse cells, where most of the time they don't even have room to lie down, which a lot of people think horses sleep standing up. And that's the case for light sleep, but to get deep rest, horses need to lay down, and they're denied even that basic need. And as I said, one of the major problems in terms of why this is what I consider animal abuse, and so do many others, including some veterinarians we have that support the ban, there's no opportunity whatsoever for freedom of movement for these horses. The thing that is most instinctual and necessary for these horses, to run around, to graze, to socialize with other horses, is totally denied them. Mm-hmm. And in New York City, in the 21st century, why are we still doing this to these horses? There's absolutely no justification.
What if they confined the carriage horses to inside mm-hmm. the park?
Right.
Could
like Tony mentioned, even if they did, the stables are on the far west side, so they would have to travel to and from every day, some of the busiest, most congested areas. Central Park is a landmark. The Conservancy would never allow stables to be built in the park. A lot of well-intentioned people say, oh, well, why can't we just keep the horses in the park? And also, you know what? Central Park is for the public. It's paid for our tax dollars. It should not go to for all this land taken up for horses for a privately run industry. That wouldn't be fair to the public, and it's never going to happen. So the reality is the stables will be on the far west side. The horses will be going through dangerous and inhumane traffic conditions every day. So all the possibilities or justifications we make really fall flat, and it just comes down to this is animal abuse. And Mayor Bloomberg is enabling it, the city agencies are enabling it, but Senator Avella and Assemblymember Rosenthal have this very exciting legislation in the state legislature, on the Assembly and the Senate, for the first time ever, to ban horse-drawn carriages in New York City, and we're really hopeful that this will pass.
And I think I have to say something for your viewers, because there's this misconception that this industry has existed for hundreds of years, and it's this institution in the city of New York. Absolutely not true. The carriage horse industry as it exists today only started around 1935, and they were only allowed to go beyond Central Park in the late 1990s. So this is actually something that it is not this long tradition that the carriage horse industries tend to portray. It's actually a very recent phenomenon in the long history of New York City.
But Mayor Bloomberg has also said that income from these carriage horses provides funding for municipal employees.
No, absolutely. It is absolutely false. First of all, the carriage horses don't charge sales tax. They don't collect sales tax, although some of them do illegally and then they pocket the money. So we're not getting sales tax from these transactions. All of these transactions are cash only. There's no record of how much money they're collecting. The only revenue the city of New York gets if these owners and the drivers are properly reporting the income they're making to the IRS, to the tax system. I've actually asked for an investigation by the IRS because I don't believe they are doing that. Because they're crying poverty, but at the same time, they're able to hire some of the wealthiest and most expensive lobbyists in the city to protect them. There's an inconsistency here. How can they be crying poverty, yet they have enough money to hire all these lobbyists to keep their industry going? Mm. And to go back to the comment, you know, that Mike Bloomberg keeps saying that this is a huge tourist industry, I think that's actually an insult to everything else New York City has to offer. As
How
Edita
is that?
Said,
How is it an insult?
People don't come to New York City just to ride a carriage, you know. That's absurd. There are so many other things that that people come to New York City for. You know, unfortunately, Mike Bloomberg and Speaker Christine Quinn have held up really dealing with this issue in New York City. And that's why it's so important to move this issue to Albany, where the mayor has much less influence.
Mm-hmm. Then also, I understand that the carriage horse industry has become unionized.
The right before the hearing that I was to holding in the city council, they went to the Teamsters, the carriage horse owners, and said, "Oh, we want to be unionized." It really isn't a union shop. There's only a small percentage of the drivers and owners who are members of the Teamsters. Now, I don't understand. A union is to protect the workers from the owners.
That's
so how can the owners mm-hmm. be members of the union?
These images conjure up ideas of tradition and times of old.
People may think of horse-drawn carriages as something that's quaint or perhaps romantic.
But this is anything but. Nose-to-tailpipe, stop-and-go traffic, the horses are forced to endure daily near misses of traffic crashes. Sometimes they don't miss. These pictures show what happens when traditional times of old meet the modern era of one of the world's biggest cities.
No horse should be forced to parade up and down congested traffic, weaving in and out of taxi cabs and trucks and tourists. This is a recipe for disaster for both people and horses. It's unsafe, it's inhumane, and it's a throwback to the past.
An independent audit conducted by the New York City Comptroller found the horses are not provided with enough water and in the summer risk overheating on hot asphalt.
The horses are forced to work year-round. In a city like New York, the conditions are just too tough on horses.
But no one here seems to notice, and while the horse, who's often elderly, is only supposed to work a maximum of 9 hours a day, those laws are not enforced. So customers looking for adventure keep getting in the carriage, putting the horse through another agonizing trot in harsh conditions. Unfortunately, the cruelty doesn't end there. When the horses are returned to their stables, they have barely enough room to lie down, essential to achieve a deep sleep. And even if they could lie down, there's not enough bedding to make it comfortable. The comptroller also found that the horses are forced to stand in their own waste because of inadequate drainage in stables.
Horse-drawn carriages do not belong in congested cities like New York City.
For these horses, there is no reward for the misery they're put through. And the Humane Society of the United States wants people to know what they're getting into when they get in a horse-drawn carriage.
So it's a cycle of suffering, exploitation, and then death. And that's just shameful for New York City to keep this going. So banning this industry would stop that cycle. It would place every single horse in a safe sanctuary, and it would change what the law currently allows them to be sent to the slaughterhouse, because there's just sort of a loophole that they can be sold and there's no records of this.
And just to make it clear, the bill includes language. Mm-hmm. That if the ban goes into effect, the horses go to humane
yes.
farms.
Right? Yeah, we helped rescue a carriage horse, a former carriage horse that was exactly in that situation, that ended up, after his owners said he was too old to be pulling carriages, ended up in a slaughter auction in New Holland, Pennsylvania. He was found because of the four digits. They have a four-digit code on their hoof, mm-hmm. and that's how it was discovered that he was a former carriage horse, and We purchased him from that slaughter auction, and he's now living in horse heaven in a sanctuary upstate called Equine Advocates. And that's what every single horse that's been suffering every day deserves right now, to be able to be horses, to be able to live in freedom and get out of this misery that they're enslaved in currently. So we really are eager to get this bill passed and get freedom for these horses.
And we're very happy to be admitting Bobby the Second, a former New York City carriage horse, to Safe Home Equine Rescue and Sanctuary. One of the reasons we're so happy to have this horse here is because it's very rare to be able to rescue a New York City carriage horse from slaughter, because their identifying factor, which is the four-digit number that's carved into their front left hoof, is usually sanded off so that no one can find out where they came from by the time they get to the slaughter auction. And just another reminder about how carriage horses, just like so many other kinds of horses that have to work and perform, get tossed after they outlive their usefulness. And it's just a disgrace. Having to go to a slaughterhouse is not a humane end for a horse like this, or any horse for that matter, but certainly this horse is so sweet and gentle, and we're just very happy to finally be able to give him a home where he's going to be loved and given the care that he deserves. He came to us lame. He came to us filled with worms. He has other minor problems. His teeth are terrible. These are all signs of neglect. I can't be sure about this, but this may be very well the first time he's ever had a chance to roll, maybe the first time he's actually been in an area where he has access to grass, except for maybe a few bites here and there in Central Park. We'll be pulling his shoes in a couple of days. He'll be getting another exam, and then eventually he'll be turned out and be in the company of two other older horses that are around his age, and one is about his age, one is a little older, and he's going to have a great home and a lot of love and a lot of attention.
Most people who take a carriage ride as some sort of, you know, nostalgic, lovely thing to do with their family or a loved one don't realize that not only is this an exploited horse who suffers day in and out and is denied its basic needs, this horse will very likely end up in a slaughter auction and possibly in a slaughterhouse in Mexico or Canada, hung upside down with its throat slit, because that's exactly what happens. Horse slaughter was made illegal in U.S. that was in the U.S. that was recently overturned, so it will be, you know, happening here again, but the horses are trucked from Canada to Canada and Mexico because people, you know, do consume horse meat in other countries. So since this is a business and it's all based on profit, the horses are mere commodities. So when the horse can no longer make a profit, can no longer pull a carriage, which happens quite often, and there's a high turnover of these horses because the life is so brutal on the street that they don't last long usually, they are then sent back. They're sent to the slaughter auctions. They're called the killer buyer auctions in New Holland, Pennsylvania. That's the largest one. And that's the last stop before the slaughterhouse, because for a broken down carriage horse that's been exploited and can no longer serve a purpose, the only way for the owner to make a profit is to sell them to the slaughterhouse. So it's a cycle of suffering, exploitation, and then death. And that's just shameful for New York City to keep this going. So banning this industry would stop that cycle. It would place every single horse in a safe sanctuary, and it would change what the law currently allows them to be sent to the slaughterhouse.
And Senator Avella has his bill, which would provide for, if such a ban took place, that these horses would be sent to a sanctuary.
Correct.
But who would pay for that?
Well, there are people who have stepped forward who said that they would compensate the carriage horse owners for whatever value the horse has. Mm-hmm. I mean, people want to do the right thing here to help end this industry once and for all.
Mm-hmm. And what about the maintenance of the horses?
Well, many sanctuaries have come forward on the East Coast and even across the country. that would jump at the chance to care for these horses for the rest of their lives. There's many equine sanctuaries across the country, and for instance, the Humane Society of the U.S. has a huge sanctuary that they could take all the horses tomorrow if they wanted to. So there would not be any lack of a home for these horses. There are so many sanctuaries just willing to take these in, and we already have quite a long list of them. Mm-hmm. So it wouldn't be a problem.
Well, if you're out there and you feel strongly about banning carriage horses in New York City, once again, please tell them what they should do.
Well, they can call my office and we can direct them to whatever animal rights organizations they can get involved in, but they shouldn't send the letter to the governor. They should contact their own assembly member or their own state senator and just say, I support Avella and Linda Rosenthal's bill to ban the carriage horse industry in New York City. Mm-hmm. Write a letter to the editor in your local weekly newspaper. Write a letter to the editor in the Daily News or the New York Times. If more people speak out, this will come to an end. And as we said earlier in the show, every poll that has been recently taken since we started the whole ban movement has shown New Yorkers and tourists overwhelmingly support ending this inhumane industry.
Mm-hmm. I myself have seen carriage horses in the city and have been very moved by how miserable they look.
The Department of Health and Mental Hygiene in the city of New York is supposed to keep records on each horse, and they're supposed to do these routine inspections. Mm-hmm. We have found out that a lot of these horses have just simply disappeared
right.
off the records.
Really? Mm-hmm.
There's no record of whatever happened to them. They were on the street right. one day, and all of a sudden they're gone. It's like mm-hmm. they never existed. Mm-hmm. So you know what's happening. They're being sold to the slaughterhouse.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Or yeah, like the Tony mentioned that sometimes a lot of New Yorkers or just tourists will snap pictures of things they see. The horse that died a few months ago dropped dead on the street. That wouldn't have even been reported. The only mm-hmm. reason it was a big story and was reported is because someone that lived in a high rise happened to see this happen and took a picture, and then it was kind of a big deal. But this would have gone just under, been swept under the rug. No one would have known about it. This poor horse that just dropped dead right after being let out of his stable. And then there was a necropsy done, which was inconclusive, but it was found that this horse had some severe health problems and should not have been on the streets mm-hmm. and under any circumstance. Yet he was somehow given a clean bill of health. It's just like, you know, there's no checks and balances going on here. Mm-hmm. The industry is just operating kind of lawlessly, and who's suffering are the horses.
I do know that mm-hmm. your organization was responsible for rescuing one of those horses. Am right. I correct?
Well, we helped along with some other organizations.
I read somewhere where a veterinarian had written, if they ban the horse-drawn carriage industry, all of these horses will be slaughtered.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's what we just right. talked about. Yeah. The legislation specifically states that cannot happen, that they'd have to be given to humane farms. People have stepped forward to say they'll even compensate the owners for the value of the horse. Mm-hmm. This is something that we're very concerned about. Mm-hmm. If the ban goes into effect, what happens to these horses? So the legislation is specifically, it outlines specifically in the legislation, that cannot happen.
Mm-hmm. And that's happening, as I pointed out now. That's what's happening now, is that they are selling them to, putting them in the slaughter auctions where they often end up in slaughter. So that's sort of, that's already what's happening. So we would stop that cycle.
So I'm looking at you, viewer, and what do you think? Should horse-drawn carriages be banned? Do you think it's a good idea? Do you think it's a bad idea? And let us know what you think. Should carriage horses be banned in New York City, or should we continue to allow it? Our guest is Senator Tony Avella and Edita Birnkrant. She is the director of Friends of Animals, and Tony Avella is the New York State Senator for the 11th District in New York, which covers Whitestone,
Bayside, Little Neck, Douglaston.
Yeah, and why should someone from Bayside, Little Neck, We don't see carriage horses that much, do we?
No, we don't. But I can tell you that since I've introduced the ban legislation in the Council and in the Senate, the overwhelming response from people all over this city and beyond, you know, from across the country and even from Europe, Australia, I've received letters of support saying this is something that New York City should not be doing. Even my constituents. You know, animal cruelty, as I said earlier in the show, I think we've grown up as a society to recognize this is no longer appropriate. And are we not better? Have we not learned that animals are part of the ecosystem of this planet? And to torture them is just inhumane. You know, it's just unbelievable that in this day and age we're allowing this practice to go on in New York City.
Has anyone ever done a poll in New York City to see what there was a CBS poll
fairly recently, and 75% of people that took that poll said they fully supported a ban on carriage horses.
75%.
Every poll that I think that has been done in the last few years show an overwhelming response for a ban. Mm-hmm. Overwhelming.
People that see these horses every day, you know, they understand that this is wrong. They see the environment these horses are in, what they're forced to go through. So.
Yes, we have a caller, Darlene. Hello, Darlene.
Oh, hello. I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
Hi. You have a question for us, Darlene?
Yes, I just wanted to give my opinion just as one person. I really feel that the horses should be banned, okay, and taken off the streets. I really feel that the inhumane treatment that these horses get and the lack of veterinary care many times that they don't get. And the sad thing is, the owners of these horses, they really don't care. They just work them to death. And after seeing where these horses are kept, there really isn't any room for them to move or sleep or lie down. This is definitely, I would consider it animal abuse. Mm-hmm. And this is just my opinion.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah. Someone like Darlene, who feels strongly about this, what can she do?
Well, she can, you know, write to the governor, write to the leader of the Senate, Senator Skelos, write to the leader of the Assembly, Speaker Silver, and say, you want to pass the ban legislation introduced by Senator Avella and Assemblywoman Linda Rosenthal. Mm-hmm. That is the best way at this point to move this legislation ahead. Because remember, the mayor and the speaker of the city council have a lot less influence in Albany. In the city, they control what goes on, unfortunately. But up in Albany, they don't have the influence that they have down here. So if people start talking to their respective senator, their assembly member, we have a chance to move this legislation along. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. We have another caller. Hello, caller.
Hi, my name is Cody Donahue. I'm in Astoria.
You're Tony?
Cody.
Oh, Cody. You have a question?
Well, I just want to express my support for the ban on horse carriages. I wanted to ask the panelists, you know, what are the opportunity costs for having these horse carriages in the park? I mean, I think ultimately people want to go around the park and tour the park and learn about its natural history, but I think we could do that in so many other ways than using horses to do that. Mm-hmm. You know, couldn't we be investing the city's time and resources in something like, you know, educational center or, you know, figuring out ways that the tourists can volunteer while they're in the city to beautify the parks. So I just wanted to see what are the other things we could be doing, you know, with these resources. Thank you.
Well, that's a good question.
That is a good question. Mm-hmm. Actually, you know, the caller came up with some good suggestions.
Yes.
I mean, there were so many things we could do to enhance the atmosphere of the park and encourage tourists to go to Central Park, but we can't get past this opposition from the mayor and the speaker of the city council. Mm-hmm. So, like, they've created this roadblock in the city, in city government. And it's hard to engage in any discussion beyond that because they just throw up this roadblock and we just can't mm-hmm. get past it.
Yeah, and they're out of touch with what the public wants. Right. They're out of touch with 21st century, mm-hmm. you know, how we should be treating animals. They're just out of touch. And I think what Cody, I think his name was, the caller, said that, you know, if people want to tour the park, there already is a great alternative, which are the pedicabs. Mm-hmm. And it actually gives you a way more thorough and in-depth tour of the park. So just in case any of the viewers, you know, would be upset because of a ban, because thinking that then that's the only way to tour the park, there already is a great humane alternative. So.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Hello.
Hi. Hello. We have another caller. Hello, caller.
Yes. Hi. My name is Steve. I'm a lifelong New Yorker. And
I've observed these horses my entire life, pretty much, and I couldn't help but notice just how miserable their existence is, just how they go from the stables to the hack line and back and forth every day. And, you know, I've read about various accidents in the newspapers, and recently, a couple months ago, the horse had dropped dead, and it just, it makes me very concerned. I just want to know if these horses are given the chance to graze at any point during their life, if they're taken outside of the city, just to experience what horses should experience, just being outdoors and being allowed to touch grass. So that's all I just wanted to know.
Thank you for calling.
Yes.
Do the carriage horses get a chance to graze?
No, I think we touched on that before. Yeah. That's one of the big problems that we have, actually. A Harvard-educated equine veterinarian that consults our ban issue, her name is Holly Cheever, and she speaks about that issue, and she says that is one of the cruelest things that you can do to a horse, is deny them of the daily turnout. They need it every day to be healthy, psychologically, you know, physically, so they're denied that. There's just simply no place for that to happen in New York, so they never get to touch grass. And actually, one of the rescued carriage horse that we were involved in saving from the slaughter auctions, the first thing he did, when his name is Bobby, when he got off that truck into this beautiful sanctuary, when he touched the grass, he started rolling in ecstasy, because probably that was the first time that this horse had ever even touched grass and been able to do that. And that's just tragic, that these horses are denied the very thing that is so natural to them and so necessary for their health. Every day, day in and day out, they are denied that.
And it was interesting, the caller mentioned the number of recent accidents, and there have been a lot. And those accidents were reported to us, to the organizations, by tourists.
Right.
By tourists.
Not by officials.
No, by tourists, which is a sad commentary on the enforcement that the city does and that the ASPCA does. But those are the incidents that have been reported. We believe there are many more incidents that go on that the industry covers up each and every day. I mean, anytime I'm in Midtown Manhattan for an event and I walk by Central Park, every time I walk by, I see an abuse of the animal or a violation of the existing law. So if I see it every time I walk by, it's got to be going on all the time.
I said, we have another caller. Hello, caller.
Hello.
You have a question?
Hi, Anna. Thank you so much for doing the show.
Thank you for calling. You have a question?
I want to tell Mr. Avella, thank you so much for everything you do. Queens loves you. We think you're fantastic.
And thank you.
I wanted to ask a question. You know, I'm just wondering what happens to these poor creatures when they can't pull the horses anymore, because you see them and they look so sad, and I just wonder, because they say they send them off and they're happy, and I've heard other things, so I was just wondering what really happened.
I'll let Edita take this one, because she had talked about this earlier.
I did mention this earlier, that yes, because this is a for-profit industry, you know, the economic model does not allow for them to retire these horses to sanctuaries and care for them. Horses are very expensive to care for, so they sell them, they place them back in the horse auctions, which are called the killer buyer auctions, because it's the last stop before the slaughterhouse. So we know that it's quite possible that many horses will end up being slaughtered, because there's just simply, they've outlived their use. They're bred into existence merely to be enslaved in you know, these industries. So once they can't make a profit, they're going to be sold for whatever small amount of money that the owners can get. There's a lot going on, you know, leading up to this bill. We also organized a lobby day, Senator Avella, which is May 1st. So if anyone wants to actually come and take part in helping make change in government, you can join us on May 1st. We're going up to Albany to lobby the senators and the assembly members and urge them to pass this bill into law.
There's also an organization called the League of Humane Voters in New York State, which actually endorses candidates. The endorsement may be the wrong word, but they list candidates in order of how they have been friendly, supportive of these type of issues. So anybody can just go on the internet and look up League of Humane Voters of New York State.
Bills that you are attempting, you're pushing for, are S 5013, that's in the New York State Senate, S5013. And in the Assembly, it's A7748. A7748.
Call voting. Your elected official and say, this is an issue that's important to me, and I will look at your record when it comes to my voting for you or not. And that has a big influence on politicians. Mm-hmm. And always, if you're going to contact your elected official, it's always best to do an individual letter. And the reason for that is, if that politician knows you took 5 to 10 minutes to do a personalized letter, you're going to remember this when you go into the voting booth. That's why that has the most impact of any way of contacting an elected official. It's better than a phone call, because you don't reach the elected official by calling, you reach staff. And it's
and
better
don't they
than
give
email.
The messages? They don't pass the messages?
I get all my messages, but uh-huh. I can tell you there are some people, there are some politicians who set up the staff to sort of act as the buffer, and they don't. And emails, there are a lot of politicians who just hit their staff, just hits delete. Delete.
Oh, wow. That's sad.
It is sad.
If you want to specifically help with the carriage horse issue, the number is 212-247-8120, and our website is friendsofanimals.org. You can also shoot me an email at Edita, E-D-I-T-A, at friendsofanimals.org.
Thank you, Senator Avella. Oh,
pleasure.
And Edita Birnkrant.
Thank you.
And I want to thank you for watching. Remember, it's people like you who take the time to write a letter or call somebody or take an action that makes things happen. Because what happens, everything in life begins with a thought. Thank you.